Welcome back to the Mentor My Mix podcast. I'm Gregory J. Gordon, and I'll be your host. Join me as we dive deep into the world of music production from both the artist and the producer's perspective. Mentor My Mix explores what makes for a great producer and the chance to get to know what makes them tick, both as everyday people and their passion for making music their lives. This is kind of the maiden flight of our new setup here at Pyramind, and I'm here with Gavin Hardkiss.
Sup?
What is up, Gavin?
What's up?
I'm so stoked to be doing this with you, man.
It's always good hanging out with you, Greg.
Gavin Hardkiss, you're kind of a Bay Area legend, dude. Man, it's kind of super cool to have you here at Pyramind Studios and to be able to talk a little bit about your career, where you've come from all these years in the Bay, and what you're up to now.
Yeah, man, I'm older than the internet.
Well, when you came to the Bay here, you came here in 91, is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
So almost 23 years ago, and that's the same time.
It's a bit more than that.
Is it? Oh, yeah, it is kind of a bit more. All right, whatever. Whatever, you know. So
you're a music guy, not a mathematician.
Clearly. So, yeah, you came to the Bay back in 91 with your buddy Scott Friedel, right?
That's right, man. Yeah.
And so he was a DJ buddy of yours from college, and you guys went to the University of Penn, and he was a bro from college, and you guys devised a master plan. Just talk a little bit about what that was like back in the 90s and coming up with this plan. How did you do it? What was the inspiration?
Damn.
I know it takes you back a minute, but I want to set the tone here. Talk a little bit about...
Give me a second to think that through.
Yeah, I know that's a big one, right?
There's a lot there to discuss. So being in college, we were into music and throwing parties and DJing and buying records and visiting record stores and meeting the people behind the scenes. And then we were doing that in Philadelphia. We were doing that in Brooklyn. And then we were going clubbing all around the East Coast. And we loved music. And then when we graduated in a recession and there wasn't a job, or there wasn't a good job market. And I had a passion for, or a dream of starting a record label. And Scott was like, let's move to California and do a music thing there. We'd been throwing parties in Philadelphia and going to clubs in New York City and hanging out with some of the East Coast techno heads like Frankie Bones and then his whole crew, which would be like Adam X and Jimmy Crash. And then we'd go to parties on railway tracks. It'd be like Mendo Music and Joey Beltram.
So when you say go to parties, just give us a sense of what that was like then. What were these parties about? Were they outdoor? Were they raves? Were they warehouses?
It was like preceding the rave scene, and Frankie Bones was making records out of Groove Records in Brooklyn, mm-hmm. and they caught on in the UK just as the rave scene was happening in the UK, mm-hmm. and he had songs that entered the top of the pops there.
Yeah.
So he was getting flown into London to play parties as like the American hero, mm-hmm. and then coming back to Brooklyn, and he was like, this is what's going on.
Right, right.
And because we were getting the magazines, like at the time, like NME and Melody Maker, like there were, and there were some DJ magazines, but not many. We saw this ad in the back of the magazine that said Groove Records.
Yeah.
And we're like, let's go check out Groove Records. And that's how we connected with Frankie. So that's how we connected with what would have been the nascent, like, rave scene, and what the rave scene was there. Like, Frankie went on to do what was called the Storm Raves, and the Storm Raves are the beginning of East Coast raving. Mm-hmm. That's where East Coast raving all started. Mm-hmm. But this is preceding it, so it would be like, hey, on Saturday night, we're going to be doing something on the train tracks, and you'd find out about it, or
Everybody knows this was pre-internet, right?
This is pre-pagers.
Oh, yeah. But, you know, it's such a whole different mentality to wrap your head around, you know, in terms of how the word got out. And did you guys feel like you were in on a big secret at that point? Not many people in America were really hip to this music back then.
It was a handful of people, and it was really cool crowd. But we were all, like, super young and wide-eyed and excited about this new sound. But I just give you the prologue. It all really started when we got to San Francisco.
Uh-huh.
So getting to San Francisco was a whole different... That was the actual beginning of the voyage of creating an identity, creating a sound, becoming music producers, becoming international DJs.
Yeah.
It all started when we hit San Francisco in the summer of 91. And San Francisco at the time, there was a coalescence, like a magnetic force that brought people here from different places from around the world. And it lit a fuse in San Francisco, and the authorities and the cops didn't even see it coming. So we got away with a lot in those first few years.
Mm-hmm. Just a lot in terms of the kinds of the scope and scale of the underground parties you could throw?
The scope, the scale, and the frequency.
Yeah.
There was parties every night.
Uh-huh.
You didn't wait till the weekend. It just didn't stop.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
It was, whether those were undergrounds or club nights or raves, it was a lifestyle and a culture. And it was a time preceding the internet. It was a time preceding computers. Like, no one had a computer, and people just used to get together and throw down and have a wild time, and people would drive in and move to San Francisco.
Yeah.
It was at the same kind of hatching point, like the internet.
But what's going through my mind is that, you know, it's like the 60s. San Francisco was such a focal point, not just for the consciousness movement, but the music, the sound, and a whole revolution in music was happening then. And it seems to me like that happened all over again in the early 90s here in San Francisco. And it's amazing to me that San Francisco constantly is at that forefront, that cutting edge of cultural revolution in that sense. And you were right in the middle of it then, right?
Yeah, we were lucky to be in a moment in time that will never be repeated. And it's wild because no one had cameras at the parties. Like, no one had phones.
Mm-hmm.
So little of it is captured and stored as people. If people were to research what happened in San Francisco, it's not on the internet. It's only in our memories.
Yeah. What were some of your favorite early locations for some of these parties that you threw? Do they even exist anymore?
I mean, there's so many good beach parties, like just meeting at a random beach, whether it's Baker Beach, which is in San Francisco.
How'd you guys even set up sound systems like that back there?
Bring a generator.
Turntables and lug them out to the beach.
And lug it out to the beach.
Uh-huh.
Like we did around Half Moon Bay, Route 1, mm-hmm. going down to Santa Cruz.
Mm-hmm.
There was different crews throwing parties. Some of my favorite ones... Okay.
Mm-hmm.
My favorite ones that I promoted. We rented San Carlos Airport.
No way.
We rented the whole airport, and they emptied out a hangar for us. And we threw a party from 10 p.m. till 8 a.m. the next morning. In San Carlos Airport.
Wow.
Like that kind of stuff.
Unheard of.
It is. And it's preceding Burning Man and that whole vibe, right? Did people dress up back then? Were there, was the costumes a thing at all, or lights or blinkies or anything like that? Or was
I think people just had their own fashion. I think what became like rave fashion is more like an LA version of what's rave fashion.
Mm-hmm.
There were club kids who'd wear like high heels, like high, whatever those are called.
Mm-hmm.
But it's t-shirts, jeans, floppy hats, maybe. Mm-hmm. I don't know. But everyone had their own version of looking good.
As is always the case.
Yeah.
Right. So you guys were mostly, this was pretty much all vinyl at that time.
Yeah.
And when did that transition for you, starting to see CDs come on and CDJing versus vinyl? And were you resistant to that when it first came around?
I never did it.
Mm-hmm.
I never went to CDs. So I put out my first record in like 92.
Mm-hmm.
And then on Hardkiss Music, we probably put out about a dozen. And then I had another record label with my buddy Niven called Sunburn Recordings. We probably put out like 20 records on that.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was doing records for other people's labels. So there's dozens of records that I've made either under the name Gavin Hardkiss or under the name Hawke, mm-hmm. that are out there in the world of vinyl. But the first CD we put out was a compilation of the first 7 releases on Hardkiss Music, and that was called Delusions of Grandeur. So that was the first time people outside of DJs would have access to our music.
Exactly.
And that went to like number 1 on the Rolling Stone college charts.
Mm-hmm.
So it really caught a wave of appreciation,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
beyond DJ rave culture.
Yeah, so when you came out here, you already had the name Hardkiss in place,
yeah.
right? So how did that name come about, the name Hardkiss?
Scott and I were just chilling on a couch, just talking about moving to San Francisco. Scott's best buddy from high school and the other Hardkiss brother, Robbie, was here. He was bussing tables at a restaurant
uh-huh.
on Lombard.
Uh-huh.
And we're like, we're going to hook up with Robbie and we're going to do this thing. And it's both hard and soft and maybe hard dance. I remember writing down hard dance. And then Scott was like, Hardkiss.
Yeah.
It was brilliant.
It was brilliant. I mean, and we're talking about Hardkiss, the name. And where it came from, you guys had come to San Francisco. We'd been talking about the parties you were throwing here. But let's really get down to talking about the music a little bit.
Sounds dope.
Yeah.
And well done with moving from chaos to collected thought.
So what was it like producing electronic music in the 90s? Now, because I know from my perspective, I came up building a studio. As a matter of fact, the very room we're sitting in right now is a room that was built in the early 90s.
Unbelievable.
Isn't that incredible?
Yeah.
And the room hasn't changed all that much, but the gear in it sure has.
Yeah. So let's just put it in perspective. Once upon a time, we came to San Francisco. There was no internet. There were no computers. And there were a handful of studios. And those studios were primarily rock and roll studios. There was like 1 or 2 hip-hop studios. And there was no one making electronic music. When I say no one, we probably found 2 or 3 people in those first year. I can list them in one hand. There was this guy, Frank Genius. He was German. He was living on Haight Street in the Lower Haight. He was making some electronic music. There were these guys, Ultraviolet Catastrophe. They had this remix service, and they were putting out vinyl of remixes for DJs. There's this Cat Single Cell Orchestra. And then we showed up, and we're like, we want to do this, but we didn't really know how to, right? So it wasn't really straightforward. We'd do parties and make money, and then rent time in studios, hoping that the engineers knew what they were doing. But you'd come into a studio and would have a couple of outboard drum modules and maybe a couple of synths. And the engineer wasn't really dialed into an aesthetic that was dance music, let mm-hmm. alone house music, let alone disco.
Right, right.
Like any of those things.
Yeah.
So there was a learning curve where we had to help them understand what we were into, and that's pretty impossible to get somebody to hear like you do. So we spent countless hours in studios with engineers who thought we were fucking crazy. Like they had no idea what we were trying to do.
Uh-huh.
Like, where's the vocalist?
Yeah.
Where are the guitars?
Yeah.
Where's the drummer?
Yeah.
None of that existed.
Sure.
So we would come in with samples and ideas.
Uh-huh.
And that's how we began a process of taking concepts and inspiration and creating music.
Uh-huh.
And really, like, the honest truth of the matter was it took a moment in time, and that moment in time was I had booked a horse race course, to do a huge party. I had 808 State coming to play at this horse race, the one in the South Bay. It's no longer there.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And the event, they got wind that there was going to be a rave there.
Uh-huh.
And they pulled the plug on us. So I ended up having 808 State play for us in the Gold Club before it was the Gold Club.
Uh-huh.
And I lost so much money on that.
Uh-huh.
I had to do like a rethink on who I was and what my priorities were.
Oh,
and I took a credit card and I went into a music store and I was like, I need to buy a sampler and something that can sequence. And I bought an Emacs 2 sampler with 30 seconds of sampling.
Sure.
I bought a sequencer that could handle that through MIDI.
Yep, yep.
And it
was it a hardware sequencer? Obviously, mm-hmm. It must have been. Yeah,
and it cost me like $5,500 for those two things.
Oh my gosh, that's right.
And, I just learned how to use that. Because we had turntables. We didn't have like samplers. So the first few records we made, all the demos were made just on the Emacs 2 sampler and the hardware sequencer, which had some sounds inside of it.
Mm-hmm.
But some of them ended up on some of our records, but it wasn't like a flesh full sound.
What was the hardware sequencer? Do you remember what it was?
Really don't.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, okay. Really don't.
But it wasn't a drum machine, right? It was.
Had sounds in it. So I'm just trying to think, you could patch it MIDI to the keyboard and you could pull the sounds up on there and sequence them in.
So this had to be mid-90s, the beginning. Of MIDI,
it was 91, like,
that
92
early?
Probably.
Okay.
Because my first record as Hawke came out 93, and it was made, the demo of it was made on that.
Yeah.
So once we had these little demos, we connected with these amazing cats who were coming to the parties. They called themselves the Ultraviolet Catastrophe. And they had their like at-home garage studio, and we'd bring the demos in there in the South Bay, and they helped us mix down.
No way.
Yeah.
And so did you, would you lay this off to multi-track tape, to 2-inch tape?
Back then, we're just going straight to DAT.
So you're just running the outputs of the Emacs right up on a console, because did it have more than 8 outs? It had 2 outs? How'd you do that?
You mean once we got in the biggest studio?
Yeah. I remember the Emacs. That was the sampler. I used to sell those at Guitar Center back in
I may have bought it from you. I don't know. So the guys, Ultraviolet Catastrophe, if I remember correctly, they had like a computer either running Performer or Studio Vision. I think it was a software called Studio Vision. And
it was Vision back then.
It was Vision.
Opcode's Vision software, yep.
And if I remember correct, they had an ASR 10 or some other sampler that may have had a bit more sample. Or maybe we brought our sampler down and they just patched in and did the sequence through Vision.
Yeah, that's how we were doing it here at the very same time.
Yeah.
Doing the same thing, because Vision, prior to being able to record digital audio, was just a sequencer.
Right.
As was Performer, which were the two major ones at the time. And this was before Pro Tools.
Yeah.
Right. This was like at the beginning of Pro Tools, Sound Designer, Deck.
There was no hard disk recording. And
that's why I was asking if you were printing it off to multi-track, because that's what we were doing here.
I got a Tascam. I got a
SR-16.
Those video, you used to put videos in them. The ADATs.
Oh my, yeah.
I had that. After we did our deal with Sony Music, we got big budgets to buy whatever we wanted. And we bought some stuff like that. But it preceded DAW's doors.
Yeah.
So it was different units that we bought to do different things.
Sure. The ADAT was a multi-track digital recorder.
Yeah,
it was eight tracks per unit that you could sync up together.
At some point, we also bought a 2-inch tape machine, like a 60 grand 2-inch tape machine. And that was just like the silliest thing. That was like 6 seconds before DAWs came out.
Now, you guys bought that, your own 2-inch?
Yeah.
Why? You were building your own studio then at that point?
Sony gave us a lot of money. We did a deal with Columbia Records, Sony, to go big time. And they gave us a lot of money, a big budget to buy studios. And God bless Scott, who just turned off the internet. He was like, we got to build a classic studio. So we put like lots of money into building a studio.
Instead of throwing more parties and doing touring?
I was done with throwing parties at that point.
Oh, you were.
I wasn't really into being a promoter. I wanted to have a record label and produce.
Yeah, yeah. But that is at the heart of what you do, the production and being creative. There's no doubt about that. So that was really the vision. And so you guys figured, okay, we're going to have our own studio, right?
Yeah, so we had a space on Steiner and Waller. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That was a dojo. This mm-hmm. guy, Pops, had a dojo there, and mm-hmm. we camped out there for maybe 8 years, probably like 7 years, like 94, 95 to 2000, something like that. Mm-hmm. And within that space, we built out studios. We built out the first like internet radio place, Groove Radio, I think it was called. Something like that, and just wasted a whole lot of money, because really, speaking for myself but also speaking for Scott, I think our ears and our aesthetic was tuned for where we are now and not for where we were then.
Interesting.
So it was really like I was always looking for a boom, like a 808 boom, to sound like a motherfucking 808 boom. Mm-hmm. And no matter whether it was tape or having an engineer or whatever, no one could figure out how to do that.
Oh, interesting.
And now it's like, you know, not a hard thing to do. You got a sample, you got 100 million samples, you got compressors in your DAW to make things sound the way we wanted to sound. Uh-huh. Keep in mind, we're not engineers.
Yeah.
So I don't know the science of sound. I've never studied engineering. And I think there's a specific kind of skill set and ear that needs to tune to both what is being created and the room and the apparatus to bring out the vision. And we never could get that. We really struggled with that.
So I find that fascinating. But before diving deeper into that, I want to understand better, what was it that got you to a place where Sony would give you that much money?
We set a precedent. Our music was revolutionary and very much influenced other people's music. So, for example, the Chemical Brothers were influenced by our sound. Mm-hmm. I toured with the Chemical Brothers on their first shows that they did around the West Coast. Mm-hmm. I opened for them. Fatboy Slim was really influenced by our sound. Sasha licensed two of our songs for his Northern Exposure CD, which put him on the map. So there were all these British kind of like, the electronic music industry was a British industry at that point.
Sure.
So whether it was the music rags or the labels, it was all happening there. And we made an impression. And our music was in high demand. We sold a lot of vinyl.
But when you got to Delusions of Grandeur then, was that what kind of broke the barriers for you guys in terms of getting out to a broader marketplace?
Yeah, we got to a broader marketplace, and we're being flown around the world and around the country every weekend to play in different cities all the time. And there were three of us who tacked Hardkiss, because the label was called Hardkiss Music. We tacked Hardkiss on our last name. So in any given city, there'd be a Hardkiss playing in any given weekend, there'd be a Hardkiss playing in three different cities around the United States. You couldn't see a rave flyer without there being a Hardkiss playing on it. And I think that there was just this general awareness that there was something happening. There was a culture that was brewing, and Sony were looking to jump into a long-term relationship with entities that could make them money.
Well, of course, that's why it always comes down to the money when you're talking major labels. But I think in a way, there's some genius behind that. The fact that you had what you called three brothers, because you weren't actually brothers, but it was in a way marketing genius to be able to call yourself brothers and each one have the Hardkiss name. So you could be in three places at once effectively.
Yeah, right? We built a blueprint for what became DJ Collectives. And so anything like Dirty Bird or anything like Desert Hearts, like the DJ band kind of thing.
Right.
We started that. And It was super early in the game. Mm-hmm. Like, it was really before people had an ear on electronic sounds. They were still listening to Nirvana.
Yeah. And nothing against Nirvana. It's just a different aesthetic. It's like, you know, are you listening to jazz? Are you listening to classical? Are you listening to rock? Are you listening to electronic music? And that was your aesthetic. And that was, I think, something that was obviously came from the underground. And that's part of that aesthetic.
It came from the underground and also came from, and still kind of is, with this little detour that was the Sony deal, which was a total nightmare experience. If I had the opportunity to relive that, I wouldn't have taken that deal.
Oh, really?
Yeah, despite the money.
And just tell us a little why. Why are you saying that?
Well, when you said, so we were like a DIY operation. Yeah. Like, we did it all ourselves. Yeah. And all ourselves meant make the music and uh-huh. have the label uh-huh. to put it out to the world. And when you're selling, like, whatever, 7,000 to 20,000 vinyl records minimum, uh-huh. like first pressing 7,000, there's a cottage industry that you have already and you have control over it. And there's strength and power to that. So once you let things out of your hands.
Elaborate on that a little bit. What do you mean? What did you have control over in that regard?
Frequency of releases, uh-huh. what the releases were, what kind of artwork went on the releases,
okay.
who we had relationships with, who could distribute those releases, who we promoted the releases to.
I see, right. And this is when you were releasing it under your own label brand at that point.
So Sony A&R approached us to do a deal, and we did the deal with them. And they were like, what do you need? And we're like, we need studios. Mm-hmm. So there were big advances that instead of being spent on renting a studio mm-hmm. or studio time, mm-hmm. went on buying studios. We actually bought 4 studios. Mm-hmm. We bought the 2-inch English Arum desk mm-hmm. main studio, and then we each bought home studios so we could work at home. Mm-hmm. But what also came out of that was, I think we lost the eye on the prize, meaning that there might have been a little bit of complacency and a little bit of ego at that point.
Sure.
That meant that nothing got done. Like, we had the equipment, mm-hmm, and, but we never finished anything.
Mm.
And there's a bigger story to that, but we don't have to get into it right now.
Okay, if you don't want to, that's fine. But nonetheless, that's in many people's eyes the pinnacle of success, right? You're touring the country, you're touring the world, you're signed by a major label, you're given a large advance, you can buy your own studio, you each have your own homes with your own home studios. To most people, that would be nirvana, right?
Yeah, if that's end game.
Uh-huh.
Like, if that's...
uh-huh. Well, we all know it wasn't end game. Things changed. Life happens, right?
Yeah.
Life happens, and a lot of that means that you have to adapt, you have to change.
You answered that really well. Life happened,
yeah,
and there was change, and Sony were looking for delivery of...
Right, they wanted
something.
They needed to make their money back.
And
that's the way these deals work. And
that never showed up.
Uh-huh.
It never showed up. So if it took 2 years to get the deal, and then 2 years to work on a project, and then 2 years to terminate the deal,
uh-huh.
like, after 6 years, you're a different person, yeah. and you kind of end up on the other side. And from the outside, it looks like you hit the pinnacle of success.
Yeah.
But I feel like we were just getting started.
Life's funny that way, because things go by in the blink of an eye, and when you're in the moment, you don't even necessarily know what's happening.
Yeah.
It's only until you can gain a little perspective on it,
yeah.
that you're able to understand all of that.
Right? Yeah. When I look back, there's experiences during that time that are just like epic experiences, but, you know, whether it's like being on stage with James Brown, or being in the Sony building signing deals with Donny Einer, or playing at the Grammy Awards, or, you know, all that kind of stuff.
Sure.
But I just want to be creative, man. That's
right.
Where my juice is, and that's where my long-term, I feel like it's my holy place.
Yeah.
It's my nourishment. It's me.
Yeah.
It's who I am.
Right. Well, you know, you got back to your center, and I think that's what I want to talk about next is Hawke. And what's Hawke doing now? Because you went through some major changes. You had a death in the group, and there's no doubt that's going to affect everybody, right? That's kind of like dropping an emotional bomb right in the middle of everything. And I'm sure that was something that's hard to get over when you're that tight as a crew, and you guys have gone through so much together. Did that take a long time to get over? Did you have to go introspective and take a break from music in order to regroup for yourself at that point? Or were you just like, no, I'm just going to keep being the creative person that I am?
It's complicated. There's so many deaths.
Yeah.
It wasn't the only one.
Yeah.
And there's so many births and that life is happening. And it's just ongoing. And during the trajectory of, let's just call it post major label.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
I just try to make albums.
Yeah.
Like wherever there was windows of time.
Yeah.
When I say windows of time, sometimes you got to feed kids and you can't really be working on creative projects, but you sneak in a bit of time.
Yeah.
And then
through
the sneaking in time, all of a sudden you got 12 songs and you're like, oh my God, I got a project. I got an album.
Yeah.
So Hawke is my solo project, and I think of it as my collaborations with people.
Yeah.
That's how I identify Hawke.
Sure.
So the first Hawke album was called Namaqua Disco, and I made that, I put that out in 97, 98.
Mm-hmm.
And then I've just done that every few years. I've put out Hawke albums and explored my skill set at self-producing.
Yeah.
Again, I'm not a trained anything. I'm not a trained musician. I can't play an instrument.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not an engineer.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, it's all a learning curve. And I feel like so now I'm on my sixth album.
Yeah, but it's funny because you say that in a way, it makes me smile because you're very musical. You're so talented. You have an amazing ear. I've sat in the studio mixing with you, and you pick things out of the mix that most would never notice, right?
So you have
an incredible ear and a knack for that.
I think that's my instrument is my ear.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I trust my ear. I know what I like.
Yeah, yeah.
But the ability to actually make music that's soulful with this technology, these computers in a box.
Yeah.
Because I'm all in the box right now.
Sure, sure.
And fine-tune abilities to do the smallest things, like take a lot of time, or did for me. And some of that has to do with having the right software. Some of that has to do with having the right hardware. Some of that has to do with being in the right headspace.
Totally. You always got to be in the right headspace. It's hard to be creative without finding some attachment to being in the right headspace. But you've been able to sustain this dual brand, though. And in a way, I'd say that's also, I'd give you a lot of credit in terms of your own personal branding in that regard, because having that identity as Hawke and releasing records under that name for as long as you have, you were doing that in tandem with Hardkiss, right?
Yeah. I put out my first record on Hardkiss in 93, and I put out an album on Hardkiss, The Dark Art of Light Work, in 2021. So what's that, 18 years
18
of putting
years.
Out music?
Yeah, that's amazing.
I always also felt like I needed to own all my music. So that's another constraint.
Yeah.
I didn't want to like just hand it over to anyone and say goodbye.
And did Sony end up owning any of those masters?
No.
No? Wow. Did you guys have to pay them back?
No.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Because I've heard a lot of horror stories in that regard. A lot of people who lose control of their masters.
Yeah.
Assigned to a label gets sold. The masters get sold. And that's it.
What a nightmare.
What can you do? You have to basically say goodbye and hope that maybe they do something with it someday. So that's a cautionary tale there.
And that's another part of my constraint is I wanted to own all my masters and all my publishing.
But you were aware of that.
I was conscious of that from the beginning.
That's huge, right? Knowing, especially if you're going into the independent music business, running your own label, and understanding those components is really, it's at the heart of all of it.
And it, you don't just understand it. You read books and you're confused for years. It's so hard to understand. But I feel like I could advise in the capacity of a lawyer at this point, because I understand how it works.
Well, you understand what it means to be a publisher.
And right? I understand what it means to be a label. That's changed in digital times.
It has changed. And how has that changed your perspective on putting out music now?
I despise Spotify. I do not participate in the business models that are the current digital streaming models. I think they're pathetic. So I don't pay any attention to, I don't see any good reason to put any effort into it, or, I don't participate.
Well, okay, I'm going to challenge you a little bit on this one. You have had a relationship with Six Degrees Records, right?
And they're the ones who have encouraged me.
I know, Bob, are you out there listening?
They're the ones who are like, come on, Gavin, this is where it's got to be. But I'm like, really? I got to scrap for pennies? I'd rather not scrap.
Right.
I don't want to. I really don't care to go after micro pennies.
Right.
I have zero interest.
But then the other side of that coin is ubiquity is what gets you known. If you're not ubiquitous on all the platforms, it's how you stay relevant, unfortunately. And
I'd rather give it away for free.
Right. Okay. All right. Great.
I'd rather give it away for free than make billionaires out of Spotify. Yeah. CEOs and other people off the back of artist music. And I feel pretty strongly about that. And I'm super, it might be a different conversation, but we can get there. And that's why the NFT thing pops up and you're like, okay, put it back in the hands of the artist.
Yes, yes. I think that's why the conversations around NFT are so important right now. And I definitely want to take it there, because we're seeing the reality of the blockchain becoming so viable now. And I know there's services now that are going to be popping up that are going to challenge the status quo of this and what that means to own a digital master that's connected to the blockchain. What has your research been telling you about this? Have you been following the development of NFTs and the sale of NFTs, and like what happened with Beeple and his ability to sell a piece of art for so much money on the blockchain?
I'm learning.
I think we're all learning, right? This is all just happening right now.
I think there's a good amount of opportunity to create value for your digital art. I'm in the situation where where people value my art already. So I'm trying to assess what that means. It's different if somebody values what you do and has it in their heart or in their mind or appreciative of it. That's a different entity to like, hey, here's something new.
Right. Let's talk about that art right now. Let's talk about the dark art of light work. Because that's 20 songs. It's a book. You've painstakingly produced some really beautiful videos for it. So it's really kind of a multimedia woven bed of music and art that you've created.
Yeah.
And you must have invested a lot of time into that. That it seems like there's a lot that went into a project like that. So how do you value that in today's climate? I mean, obviously you have some issues with the way it's being distributed, and It is on Spotify, though.
Yeah, Bob. I first released it on Bandcamp last year, and I released it as a book. So if people wanted the Bandcamp digital versions, they had to buy the book.
Okay.
I like the idea of creating an artifact that you could hold in your hands. And I've done so much vinyl through the years that I thought it would be interesting to make a book. And it was. The book is about how the imagination creates reality.
Yeah.
And it's a tour through various esoteric ways of looking at reality and creativity, and how as an individual we create our own worlds.
Yeah.
And I had a vision to take the text and insight from the book and incorporate it with the music in a multimedia display. But COVID put a dampener in any types of event space concepts.
Yeah.
And so I shipped out the books of the Dark Art of Light work the day we went into shelter in place.
Oh my gosh.
Last year. So it was the last day that the poster that we I was allowed into the post office. And then I actually played in Sacramento the weekend before that, which was the first rave where I was playing all my original music with a projection show, which included the text from the book. And it was epic. It was really meaningful to people who caught the message of what I was trying to lodge in their brain, both through sound and through what they were seeing on the screens. I worked with a video artist on that event, and I had aspirations of going out and doing more events in different capacities with the video artist. We were at this moment in time where we had to put things on pause for a year. So what I did was I created workshops for people to join me in talking about the Dark Art of Light work and putting people through activities and information and learning environments so that they could embrace some of the things that I've come to understand for their own use. So that helped me actually get through last summer and into elections, which was a really difficult time for everyone. And so connecting with people and helping them and then reinforcing my own perspective on things through that teaching kind of mentoring environment, that was helpful for me. That's what I did during COVID with Dark Art of Light work, and just worked on a hell of a lot of remixes and different versions of the songs. There's so many places I'd like to go with it that are not like listen to it on Spotify, and we'll see how it grows. Sometimes things take on a life of their own.
Well, it seems to me like it's almost been, it's a bit of a mirror of your own personal spiritual journey. Right? The message in the music, the messages in the video. I know I was watching the Melody in My Heart video earlier, which is a beautiful piece. Really, it's a beautiful piece of art in and of itself. And this is Joe Milliner and Jamie Stevens remix on here. And you created the music video for it, right? And that looks in itself was pretty painstaking because there's a lot of imagery, very evocative imagery in there. Talk a little bit about how you made the video, maybe.
My friend who does VJing with me, Kevin Colorado, he builds computers and he built me a server. And so I had it in my studio during COVID and I downloaded the free version of DaVinci Resolve and started playing around with learning video editing and how to collage still images. I felt like COVID was a good time to learn new skills, that was one that I was like, I got to learn how to edit video, and if I can learn how to animate, that would be like two solid growth opportunity to learn new things. I just spent a lot of time working on 6-second increments, 3 and 6 second increments, and just dozens of 3 and 6 second ideas, and then figured out later how to put them together. A lot of the music I make is at 120 BPM, so it's easy to divide the time signature.
60 beats per minute, 60 seconds, so forth.
So you can you can build out 6 seconds in ways that it starts feeling like it's in the music.
Yeah, it definitely has that feel. It's very, it all feels very synced, very synchronized. And the messaging, too, allow the universe to observe through you, find your own meaning. And one that I loved a lot was suck the wisdom from your tongue. where did all these come from?
It's part of the book I wrote.
So these all came from your book.
All the texts that is in the video comes from the book I wrote. And it's a powerful book, man. It's, it pulls together a lot of esoteric information and knowledge in bite-sized Twitter speak. Because I find sometimes it's the knowledge of the world and the wisdom of the world is in such dense books that it's unapproachable for most people.
Right.
But if you can, which I think it comes from songwriting, condense metaphors and create shorter sentences,
yeah,
you make it palatable for people to start understanding some of how the invisible world works, or yeah, how the forces outside of the obvious,
yeah, the reality, subtle planes of reality.
Uh-huh. Yeah, outside of our five senses, how that's, what's going on there.
Mm-hmm.
And I find that very interesting and curious. Mm-hmm. We're all spiritual people, but we don't really understand what it is we believe in.
Mm-hmm.
We're all kind of children in our belief systems. We're quite, let's say, yeah, whether it's our ideas of gods or angels or Santa Claus or spirits, yeah, and gnomes, we have these childish ways of approaching that which we can't see.
Yeah.
And I realized how we can create our own entities and populate the world with those. Like these entities that we've been given through our parents and our culture are just one form.
Are you referring to like entities and that are a part of organized religion?
Talking about what is spirituality? What are we praying to? Who uh-huh. are, what's our interaction with? What is meditation? Where is this going?
Uh-huh.
Like
uh-huh.
when my mother-in-law is into angels, like uh-huh. what is that thing that she likes that protects her? It's an angel. Like she thinks of it in terms of like how you a five-year-old would think of it,
uh-huh, uh-huh.
or how we think of Satan, or how we think of the elements or the directions.
Yeah, yeah.
These are all man-made figments uh-huh. that have been passed through time, but we can make our own.
Right.
We can make new ones.
Right. Some would say figments of our imagination, or are they really figments of a higher awareness?
Yeah, exactly.
And is that, and so if you were to sum up the wisdom of the dark art of light work, how would you encapsulate that?
I like vague terms that stimulate thought, like the dark art. It's mm-hmm. contradictory, the dark course, art yeah. of light work. So mm-hmm. I'll let anyone who's interested interpret that mm-hmm. in their own way. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to offer a way to interpret that.
Yeah.
But I feel like as humans, we have this instrument that's our mind through which we perceive the world. And it's also how we impact the world. So all of our senses are processed through our mind, and we're at play in this world and enjoying it and participating. And that's feeding a greater power, whether you want to call it the universe or cosmic consciousness or God or whatever that is, this infiniteness. So we're experiencing the world and feeding it, and it is feeding us.
Mm-hmm.
And it's that relationship that you learn through living your life and becoming better at activating what consciousness with a big C is presenting to you that enables you to really create your own world and influence the world
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and communicate in ways that are not words or conventional.
Mm, yeah. And you have to open yourself up to that potential, because I know from what I see daily is the noise channels are very high, right? So when you talk about being influenced or being channeling your own vision, each and every one of us are influencing each other. So how to separate that influence, that noise factor of social media, of news or whatever it might be, from what your actual sensibilities are telling you, and where's the difference? There's a fine line, because we're so programmed now. And I call that being plugged into the matrix. Whether we're in a pod with something jammed into our spine or not, we're jacked into the matrix because of that level of influence on our mindsets and our thinking.
Yeah.
You know?
you're right. And I feel like the first thing is being aware of it. Mm-hmm. Most people are not. So once you're aware of it, you can start eliminating parts of it that aren't serving you, mm-hmm. whatever that may be. For me, there's obvious ones that are just not serving me at all, whether that's cable television, news,
sure,
or for that matter, Facebook, or most of popular culture. Each person has their own practice to get to a place where they start to understand their relationship with, whether it's their higher self, their guides, their future self. You need to find that for yourself. No one's going to take you and hold your hand into that understanding.
Yeah.
And it's not also going to come easily or in youth.
No, I'm sitting here just thinking of the irony of the discussion we were just having as I was being distracted by a chat on Twitch.
Yeah.
And just those words, if you took them out of context, you'd be like, huh? What does that mean? And this is the first time I'm actually streaming this podcast live. And so it's cool that we have these channels, but it's so cool that you have an ability to take the music that you're producing now, despite all these channels, and even with your resentment towards these kind of abusive channels of distribution, as I would think that's as you're seeing it, right?
Yeah.
That despite it all, you're still expressing your creativity at such a high level. That's, I'd say kudos to you, because it's easy for people to just say, oh, screw this.
Yeah. I like the tools. Like, I'm really into these digital tools that, like I mentioned, when I first started producing music, mm-hmm. I didn't feel like we had the tools then.
Yeah.
I felt really restricted.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I know my partner, Scott, I know some of the stuff that he went through.
Yeah.
And the amount of money that he spent and the resources he spent on getting live musicians and time stretching.
Oh, wow.
Everything so it fit on a grid.
Uh-huh.
Like, uh-huh. Come on.
Yeah.
Anyone can do that in the box now. You take that for granted.
You do.
But back then, can you imagine trying to do that with a full, like, 8 minutes of live drums and guitars? Like, wow. How do you even do it?
Yeah, you'd have to put it in a sampler and time compress and time expand, and it takes for it would take you hours and hours. Yeah.
So that's the thing I'm in love with as a digital artist right now, is my ability to conceive and then create.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't let anything stop me.
Yeah, yeah.
So if I have an idea, so I'll give you a good example, but it's a bad example because it's illegal, but it's a good example.
Sure.
There's a song that I have coming out soon called The Bells of San Anselmo.
Mm-hmm.
And I wrote the song and I had this awesome music and I had this like world, texture of sound and beats, and I really wanted a Indian sarod, and I wanted to add that element to it. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to get a sarod. I'm like, where'd you get a sarod from?
Yeah.
So there's the Indian school down the road from us in
Ali Akbar. Yeah.
Uh-huh. I got in touch with them,
uh-huh.
and I was like, hey, I want to have a live musician come in and play. And they put me in touch with one of their head musicians, and he didn't like electronic music. So I asked him to put me in touch with his student,
mm-hmm.
one of his students who could do it, and they weren't into it. And I'm like, God, you people, man, uh-huh. this is creativity, and I'm trying to do it the proper way.
Right.
But so the way I tend to do things is I'll go to YouTube and find my favorite sarod player, uh-huh. and extract the audio and find a way to manipulate it.
Mm-hmm.
And then like within a couple of hours, I have sarod,
mm-hmm.
in my music. Now,
sure.
Some may see that as being illegal or cultural appropriation. I don't really give a fuck. I'm a collage artist. I'm going to steal and borrow from wherever I can find it.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And my ability, uh-huh. right now to have the idea, like I want a sarod,
uh-huh.
and within a few hours have the sarod, uh-huh. in my song,
yeah.
is a godlike power, mm-hmm. as a creator. And mm-hmm. you can see how you can do that in many forms, and if you're unlimited, mm-hmm. whether you're writing or making video or you're making music, mm-hmm. if you're unlimited in your scope of thinking, it's all at your fingertips.
It is. Well, I think the idea behind that, that for me is justifiable, is manipulating the sound to where the intention of the original music is no longer there, and you've created something completely different and new. Now, I know that's perfectly arguable, and that there's technically no legal amount of sampling that can be done without clearance, and certainly I understand that. But I think, to your point, it is the technology that is enabling in such an amazing way to do this and create a whole different, in a way, it's its own art form.
Yeah, there's no limit right now other than your own mind.
Yes, no limit in our own mind. So we're coming out of COVID. We're going to be doing shows. We're going to have opportunities to perform, gather, and do things again. Where do you see this going for you now?
I love DJing, so if somebody invites me to DJ, I'd love to play. Mm. That's a good way for me to express myself and the sound, is to just be hired to play as a DJ.
But this is a multimedia experience in a way. Do you see an opportunity to perform it in that way?
I do. I don't have a manager or like a agent who's going to go out there and find that shit for me.
Uh-huh.
And I'm sick of the hustle of knocking on doors uh-huh. and being like, hey, dude, look uh-huh. at me. I can do this too.
Uh-huh.
So at right. this point in time.
Well, you've done it. It's not like I can do this too. It's like, I've done this, right? I've proven myself.
At this point, my emphasis is on what I have control of mm-hmm. rather than what's possible as far as how I get this out there. So right. what I have control of is doing cool remixes, getting friends to do remixes, mm-hmm. getting those versions into the inboxes of top DJs around the world,
yeah.
have them play them,
yeah, yeah.
and keep feeding them cool versions of the dark art of light work. Because for me, a lot of the music was made 2 years ago. My closest fans would have heard it last year. It's on Spotify and Apple Music as of February or March. So it's out there, but it's old for me.
Yeah, sure.
So I need to keep it fresh for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I know these versions that I'm getting into DJs' inboxes, for them, it's the first time they're hearing it.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Like I could really hold a dance floor and hold people's attention and put something meaningful together within just the context of this album. Yeah. Meaning, like, I have so much other music and other worlds to bring into a DJ performance, but just this performance is something special. Like if I could do anything, it would be a multimedia presentation where it would be me and, at a minimum, a VJ and the ability to do very large projection. Not like a small screen, but a scaled projection.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I would love to present this in that capacity.
Yeah, I could see this going over very well in an immersive type projection environment. I was down at Area 15 not too long ago for their opening. They have a portal gallery back there. My friend Sean Ahern produced amazing, super cool Pink Floyd influenced 360 projection 20-minute film that he screened in there, and to a lot of adoring fans, people loved it, and it was very cool. And it was based on the story of kind of the origination story of Syd Barrett,
yeah,
and his contributions to the early stages of Pink Floyd. And I could see something like this in
yeah.
that capacity.
So speaking yeah. to that, just so you understand a bit more of where my head is, it's always been there, but especially post-COVID,
mm-hmm.
I'm done with Pink Floyd. They've had 40 years or whatever it is. Like, I'm super like aware that there are these icons from the 60s and the 70s who were great.
Yeah.
But there's great amongst us now.
I couldn't agree with you more. I was just using that as an example.
What I'm saying is throw a bone to the great that's around us now. And I'm not saying necessarily me, but there are other producers and visionaries in San Francisco and other places around the world. But
Don't sell yourself short, Gavin. Don't sell yourself short here.
I think we need new heroes.
Right. But you're obviously continuing to produce music. You've got more tracks coming out. We're going to be doing a track together coming up, aren't we? Am I going to work on one of your tracks here? We're going to do a little mixing, aren't we?
I would love to do that.
I would love that too. And I think I even want to live stream some of our mix sessions now that we got our whole setup going on here.
That would be pretty sick, man.
So I think you even brought a track with you today, didn't you? You got a track set up over here?
Is
that something we could maybe even take a look at, get a little sneak peek at something?
For sure. Let me just open it up.
Give us a little overview of the song first. What's this track about?
Okay.
What's the inspiration behind this?
All right. So this song's called Ping Pong, I Love You. And it's one of the songs from The Dark Art of Light Work.
Yeah.
And it originally came from me thinking of a ping pong game where two lovers are playing ping pong and then they end up making love halfway through the set. And I wanted to make a song that incorporated like all that orgasmic nature and that gaming competitive prelude to the sex. That was the image, the vision I had. So I sampled some ping pong sounds and used them as percussion. And then I found voices that say the words, I love you. And I manipulated those so that they became like a dialogue or a vocal theme through the song. And then I created all these awesome beds of synthesizers on beats, like dance beats, and built up, I think it's like an 8-minute song.
Yeah.
But DJs who like the song had been struggling with the ping pong sounds in the beginning of the song as far as having a clean mix in.
Sure.
So as the utility of the song wasn't there for DJs. So I figured I'd make a version that was more for DJs. And then I thought I'd remove like the 4-to-the-floor dance music element and introduce like a classic Hardkiss breakbeat. People telling me breakbeats are coming back in, so I figured I'd put some breakbeats in there for the kids. So
I think we need some breakbeats in our step these days, you know? Coming out of COVID, we're all going to need to be doing some breakbeating, you know?
Yeah. So I had the song, like, I love the song, and then a break kind of jumped out at me that would work well in the song. So I eliminated all the percussion sounds, including the ping pong. So there's no ping pong left.
Okay.
But there's the break beat.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've just been playing around with it. I think it has a feel that would work well this summer.
Cool. Let's hear this coming summer groove. Let's check it out. Why don't you play it for us?
Okay, cool. DJ intro there, that's perfect for mixing for DJs. They need their like 16 bars to get in the song.
Yep. And here we're coming up on our 16. Boom, bap. Yeah.
So I would certainly play this in anything. It feels good to me.
So maybe just walk us through your session a little bit here as we're listening to it.
I'm usually not as organized as this, but I've kind of created groups of the different elements. So I'll just close. I have a hats element, a Vox element, bass element, I mean group, atmospheres, the knocking sounds, synths, and there are a lot of different synths.
Just go back to your drums a second. Are we hearing manipulated or chopped up digital audio loops here? Is that what we're hearing?
Yeah, I'm not gonna solo it. But
you don't have to solo it. That's fine.
We have this breakbeat that's just cut up and made into something that's not a one bar repetition.
Yeah.
And then the other thing I'm playing with here is I have a second track that's the same break, but it's processed differently. Because I kind of wanted to have a part of the song where it feels like the music is bigger than the beats, and another part where the beats is bigger than the music.
Ah.
I've never really done that before, but I that's what I'm playing around with here.
It's cool. I like the chop edits on it. That gives it a nice...
Yeah.
It gives it a, it changes up the breakbeat feel and gives it like a stutter edit vibe, which is cool.
Yeah.
All right, we got a little break here. Nice.
And as you know, I like to do my mixing and mastering in the studio. Mm-hmm. So, like, I don't even try get the best quality version. Like, I don't even try get the final version when I'm doing it in my computer here.
Sure, sure.
So this will be crispy and big by the time we're done with
it. Oh, yeah. That's going to be huge. So walk us through some of the synth plugins you're using. What do you like to use in here? Obviously, we're looking at Ableton. Are you in Ableton 11 yet, or are you looking at 10? I can't tell from here.
I think it's 10. Yeah. I don't think it's 11.
Yeah. You're in Ableton 10 here.
So I have, like, I've flattened, not flattened, but...
Frozen the tracks.
Frozen a lot of the tracks, but here I'm using an Oxium synthesizer, which I kind of like. I mean, there's lots of different ones. This one is already flattened. It might have been an Oxium 2. What else do I have here? This SEM, that's Arturia. I love the Arturia synth.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of different Arturia stuff. This part that comes in now kind of rides through the rest of the song. It's kind of... I'll stop talking for this part.
So I'll bring it up a little. We'll listen to it. So this is where the vocal samples hit here, yeah.
Prophet V3 down there. That's also Arturia. I was playing with this Massive at 2 a.m. this morning. I'm not sure if it's going to stay. I'm not sure if it's in key, but I kind of wanted to... increase the orgasmic sexual tension.
Nice. So when you say Massive, are you talking about NI's Massive synth here?
Yeah, this guy.
Oh yeah, love that.
You can hear the riser coming up there. I don't think I'm finished with how it's gonna sound, but you're gonna help me with that.
I'd love to. So what's the automation line showing us there? What are you automating? You got an automation
filter
line.
Filter cutoff. I automate a few different things. It depends in different. I usually automate filter cutoff, but it's. I usually just play around with knobs and see if it sounds better or worse.
Sure. Oh, well, cutoff frequency is a classic.
Yeah.
Opening and closing the filter on it.
Yeah. What other synth is this?
What's that? That pretty tinkly arpeggiated one right there. Is that an Arturia synth?
That's, yeah, the SEM, S-E-M.
Okay, so where'd that nice big fat piece of audio come from there? Is that a sample?
No, that's...
Is that something you printed?
I printed it. It's a... okay, can you see my cursor?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So that's
yeah,
the those are the MIDI notes.
Oh, I see. Those are the MIDI notes for the audio above there. It. Yeah.
But
yeah.
I last again at 2 a.m. this morning, I was trying a different synth.
Mm-hmm.
But what I've been doing since, like, I have this Schwarzenegger, which kind of helps me get chords going.
Mm-hmm.
And I printed it because it's a good thing I printed it because I forgot what Schwarzenegger chord set I used, and I couldn't find it again. I had to go to an earlier version. I'm like, what the hell? It doesn't sound right. So I find new tools to play around with, and then they kind of like hang out until I get a new computer, and then you're off to new tools. But that Schwarzenegger, it's kind of a really nice way for me to get chord structure without knowing how to play chords or eliminating the bad notes. Let's see what else we got in here.
Are you you're working with a controller of any kind?
I do have a controller, you know, synthesizer, keyboard controller.
Sure.
I tend to be like, I can just do it on the keyboard here.
Sure.
I mean, I'm at the point now where everything I do is in this box.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And, whether I can do it on an airplane, I can do it on vacation, mm-hmm. I can do it in my studio. Mm-hmm. If I have an extra synth, it's mm-hmm. great. If I don't, mm-hmm. fine. Mm-hmm. You mm-hmm. know, I like, this is my tool, you know, I have my VSTs that I go to.
Mm-hmm.
I have favorite plugins, and I'm pretty happy with it. I don't have anything that needs an outboard piece of, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. added mm-hmm. cumbersomeness.
Sure. Well, it keeps it, keeping it in the box certainly gives it a much more flexible, easy production process to everything. And, you know, then the challenge is getting the sound you want out of it, you know? And I think the creativity is where it starts, though, because without that, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You know? So.
Yeah. It's, I've been doing it for so long now that there's no frustration from idea to implementation.
Mm-hmm.
But I spent a long time being in that world of like, how do I get my ideas out? How do I make the things I'd like to hear?
Yeah.
And now I know how to do it.
Yeah.
So that's a experience and skill set that develops over time.
Yeah.
You don't just pick that up, you know,
mm-hmm.
when you get the software or get the computer.
No.
It doesn't come, the computer doesn't come with that.
Right. You can't jack your brain into there. You don't have, there's no MIDI port on the back of your head, you mean? Is that?
No. But, and like, I really try keep it down to, I probably have like 10 different synths in here.
Yeah.
I don't have 100. I'm not trying to like have everyone. And some of the go-to ones that seem popular that I hear people talk about, I don't use much of what Ableton offer, like their
The native plugs, native instruments.
I use some of their plugins.
I shouldn't use the word native. I mean Ableton instruments.
Right.
Yeah.
I use some of their processing, like their. Uh-huh. I use like their delays. I don't use their reverbs.
Uh huh.
I use their compressor for sidechaining.
Uh-huh.
I might just use their limiter.
Standard compressor or the glue compressor? You use the glue?
For sidechaining?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, I just use a standard one.
Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah.
You could introduce me to the glue one. I like kind of connecting with other producers because they show me different ways to do things different from, you know, how I've taught myself to.
Mm-hmm.
So you could show me that. I really like Waves plugins.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the what's his name? Clive Lloyd Allen. Is that his name?
Chris Lord Allen?
Chris Lord Elge.
Yeah.
I love his
what do you got there? Which one is that?
It's a guitar, like it's guitar, it's just a guitar. Like, I'm not that advanced. Like if you gave me a compressor and said, like, make the sound sound better with a compressor, I don't know what to do. Uh-huh. I just move knobs around until it sounds good. This at least gives me some, it limits the interface.
Right, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So it's like I push it up or I push it down.
Yeah. Well, I mean, knowing what to do is knowing the parameters and how to use them obviously speeds your process up. But there's always an element of experimentation that can come into it, whether you know it or you don't, that can create amazing effects. But like learning how to use a compressor and knowing the effects of the attack time versus the release and, you know, the threshold and where to set your threshold, all those things make a huge difference. But, you know, clearly you've got a nice warm sound here. So, again, the ear wins out, I would say.
The ear wins out. Mm-hmm. And like my friend, my partner, Robbie Hardkiss, he pointed out in our collaborations, he's like, Gavin, I like to, like, design houses or mansions and every room in the mansion. He likes to, like, weave a rope into a knot, right?
Uh-huh.
So that's like, there's some people who just want to take one element and get that perfect. I want to build the fucking house, man. I want to go and build a whole environment. I want to do the album. I start with the album, not with the kick drum. And that's kind of been my approach. Like, I couldn't care if the kick is this or that, and I wouldn't know how to jack it in a certain direction so it would be better. I'm not going to spend much time on the kick. I'm spending more time on mood, feeling, the adventure, the sequence, the arrangement, and then how to build it, flesh it into a bigger project.
Well, I think that's what makes you more prolific in the end, because when you get caught up, I'm just going to turn this down a little bit here. I think when you get caught up in the new, in the overly subtle elements of a mix, you lose yourself in the journey there. It's really easy to get lost in the nuance and the details. And I'm not saying they're not important, because I do believe that there's an element to that that can make the difference between a good and a great album. But being able to, you know, create at a higher volume and then being willing to go into a studio and work with others who can address the nuances, you know, I really do believe it takes a village. You know, there's so many people I think that struggle with that because they're in their home studios and they think they've got to do it all themselves.
Exactly.
And I think I don't condone that practice, because I feel like no man is an island, especially when it comes to producing and being creative. And I think having other perspectives, having other ears to bounce it off of, and I think, you know, you spoke to it earlier, having a community, having a collective. The fact that you had three guys, I'm sure there was a lot of back and forth over tons of tracks that you guys worked on, right?
Yeah, and there's a lot of, like, natural ability that individually we have, just nascent, and the others will never have.
Right.
Like, Robbie's got the funk. Like, Robbie can spend a week on hi-hats. You know? Scott has drama and emotion. Like, Scott could bring drama and emotion better than anyone I've ever seen in dance electronic music.
And how do you tap into that now? That partnership, that collaboration, is that still there?
I think it's just I've internalized the funk and the emotion. So I have a piece of them in me. The emotion part is, it's kind of tricky as an experienced musician, and knowing that music needs a place, a time and a place to be played. Most people at clubs don't want the emotion. So you got to be really, it takes a special DJ and it takes a special moment to really bring the emotion. Most nightlife is hyped entertainment, and, you know, it's nighttime, it's dark, it's it's for that. So for you to bring something that's hits a nerve, it's a more rarity now, so, and it's something that Scott would bring regularly. And also Robbie bringing the funk. I mean, you know, we all have our favorite DJs who have that part to them. I don't go out a lot and hear funky DJs.
No. Sure. Well, you know, at its core, music is emotion, right? I mean, it is an evocative.
Somewhat, but the nightlife tends to want to be monodimensional in its presentation of itself, whether it's the type of party that it is, that they're going to have a certain sound.
Yeah.
Or,
and well, that's the difference between a nightlife party music listening environment and, say, listening to a soundtrack of a film,
totally,
right, that evokes all kinds of emotion. The two can merge, though, and I certainly hear elements of that in what you do.
Yeah.
And I think, for better or for worse, it is, you know, the nightlife is the place where we experience a lot of electronic music, and a lot of that is driven by the party vibe. That is nightlife. But I think it's more, you know, and at its core, it's more than the party vibe, because there's an element of us coming together in that space that brings brings some spiritual value to it, whether we want to admit it or not,
right?
You know, and whether, you know, the younger folk want to even acknowledge it or even realize it, that is a part of what we're doing.
It very much is. We're connecting in a space. That space would be really different if it was just you on your own and the DJ.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
I want to go back to just, because I know this will be on a podcast, and people might be listening, producers or engineers or creators may be listening.
Yeah.
I just wanted to point out something that helped me in my evolution as a songwriter and a album writer and a electronic musician. And that was, I think about writing music as wearing different hats. So you need to approach different parts of the process with different hats. So there's, at its simplest form, there are three hats to wear. There's the creative hat, coming up with ideas, throwing them out there, playing around with your sound, being inventive. And then there's you go to sleep and wake up the next day, put on your next hat, which is the arrangement hat.
Yeah.
And it's how does that kind of come together, and what's the sequence, how does that lay out, how's that going to be heard, and then you put that down and you go to sleep and you come back with the mixing hat. And not everyone's going to be good at all those things.
No.
So for me, instead of stressing myself about the mixing, I just get help.
Yeah. And there's, it's totally, totally valid. I know, like, in a lot of the curriculum that we develop, we've been developing an artist producer curriculum specifically for this, and it's broken into four parts, actually.
What are your parts?
Well, there's the technology, right? Learning the interface, learning how it works, being comfortable enough with it so it gets out of the way, right? Because if the technology gets in the way and you're trying to find what you're doing and figure out how it works, then it stifles the creativity.
Exactly. Right? That's a huge part of it.
And it's a huge part of it, because for creativity to work, you have to flow. And in order to flow, there has to be as minimal a barrier to that process as possible. So that's the first thing that we work on. Then the next piece, as you said, is the arranging, right?
Or the creativity?
Yeah, well, the creativity is the flow that comes
within
from...
the flow.
That
and
comes,
then the arranging?
Yeah, and then the arranging then leads to more creativity, right? And then trying to build a basis of that with music theory so that there is a musical connection in that process, right? And then there's the sound design, right? How do you design these sounds to make them sound compelling and unique and inviting and rich and exciting and whatever emotion it is that you want to evoke, And then there's the mixing and, of course, the mastering process.
Yeah.
So that's probably more than four, but it's kind of in a sum total of four sections, you know, that that whole creative process has to entail, right? And it's a lot. It's a lot.
Can somebody sign up and go through a course load of all of that?
Yeah.
Over what, a year?
Over a year.
One year.
Yeah. And the reason we take it out over a year is because in order to get to that flow state, in order to get really comfortable with your workflow, it actually takes some time.
Yeah.
It doesn't happen in 30 days.
Yeah.
It doesn't happen in one video.
Yeah.
And you combine that with coaching, you know, and feedback so that there's a cyclical process in this. And that's how we start to see really amazing things happen, you know, and I'm excited about it because this process is, you know, it's taken us a long time, even as a learning institution, to really see how people learn and how it affects them on a deep level.
Yeah.
You know? And that's what makes for great artistry, you know.
Yeah.
And I mean, look how long you've been doing this. Right?
Yeah, I've been doing it a long time. Like I said, the first thing I had was a 30-second sampler and a keyboard.
Yeah.
And the songs that were made with just that,
yeah,
the ideas that were put down with that, people still listen to those songs every day now.
Yeah, yeah.
I could play you one of those if you wanted to hear one.
Yeah, yeah, sure. Go for it. Why not? We got you jacked in here. Let's hear it.
So I actually love this DJ software called Flow.
Mm-hmm.
The mixed and key guys make Flow. So I use that instead of Pioneer Record Box. So when I DJ and I have to show up with everything, meaning, you know, I'm the DJ,
yeah, yeah,
and I'm playing at someone's party or something, I do everything in this Flow, in Flow Deck. Let's see what we have here. We have... Oh, I don't want that version. I sampled Mick Jagger for that version.
Have you seen Mick Jagger's latest song with,
yeah,
Dave Grohl?
I don't really like it, but I'm glad he's making music.
Can you believe it? At his age, man, it's amazing just to see him making music and still singing his heart out. But I kind of agree with you. It fell a little flat for me. Easy, sleazy, whatever it was.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's put it out of... I don't know how loud it's going to come. Let's just put it out.
That's fine. Go ahead, play it. And
there you go.
All right, so what are we listening to?
So we're listening to Rain Cry.
Uh-huh.
It was Hardkiss 4, came out in 1994.
Uh-huh. Wow.
See?
Same breakbeat in a way.
That's why I wanted to make a version now that harkens back to that.
Yeah, yeah, it takes you right
back.
You
can see how I could mix the two together
totally.
And 30 years apart.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I remember this track. I love the reverb on it, by the way. Was that in the original sample, or did you guys put the reverb on after the fact?
I'm pretty sure the engineer put it on.
Yeah, sounds great. You just don't hear reverbs like that these days on snares. It's great.
Yeah, so this is called Rain Cry, and this touched a chord with a lot of people.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And really kind of, it's a classic.
Was this on Delusions of Grandeur?
It was, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh. all of this music was only available on vinyl and CD. Uh-huh. And then like 5 years ago, we did a crowdfund fan type of thing so we could re-release it digitally.
Yeah.
So we got everything remastered.
Uh-huh.
And got it into the digital system. But it wasn't there before, I think.
So it's almost like you're getting to remix your own stuff now, right? I mean, in a way, it's kind of cool.
Well, that's why the NFT thing.
Julian, he's telling me he loves that Hardkiss track.
Yeah.
We're getting texts here. All right. That's awesome.
That's why the NFT thing kind of appeals to me, because we can make versions of things.
Uh-huh.
and then make them really special for that handful of people who really want that.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
And whether they want it for $10 or $100 or $1,000 or $1,000,000.
Uh-huh.
It's more than 0.0001 cents
for a stream.
Which I just can't wrap my head around. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it is the difference between ownership and renting a bike for an hour or so. I don't know. How do you justify it? It's hard.
It's a bit different because when you rent a bike, I think when you're renting a bike, I mean, there's money going into the pocket of the person who bought the bike, and there's somebody who's making a transaction that it isn't just a monetary vehicle to create wealth for shareholders and for major labels.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what Spotify is. And no one can talk me down off of that because I know what Spotify is.
No, yeah, I think your point is well taken. And I think at the end of the day, the reason Spotify exists and iTunes exists is that the labels cut deals to become shareholders,
exactly.
Right? So that they would sell cheap streams in exchange for becoming shareholders in a platform that was going to make them rich and screw the artists.
Exactly. So it was one more screw the artist moment.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the final one because it's done. That model's done. Like, it's profitable for, you know, whatever, the 100 top artists in the world.
Yeah.
But for no one else.
Yeah.
And everyone else is slave to that system.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, it's another example of winner takes all here in this world that we're living in.
Yeah.
Technology dominated world. And, you know, so what do you do? You know, you got to go out on the road. You got to tour. You got to, you
know. Oh, you do NFTs.
Mm-hmm. NFTs.
I haven't explored it mm-hmm. enough to mm-hmm. find somebody who's doing it in a way that's mm-hmm. proof.
Yeah.
Like, I think I need to do it in the way that proves it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm in conversation right now with the four creative parties who made Delusions of Grandeur. So mm-hmm. it's like me, Robbie Hardkiss, David Christopher, who produced Rabbit in the Moon, and Scott's wife, Stephanie. Mm-hmm. And we're all like, let's try this out. So it's, mm-hmm. we don't have to go to a lawyer. We don't have to go to a label. It's the four of us are like, okay, let's give this a shot.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's great. No more jumping through hurdles. But now what is it we're going to do?
Mm-hmm.
So we're in the conversation now amongst ourselves. Oh, what would be cool to do? What would fans respond to? Because although it would be interesting to bring in new people, it really doesn't matter if you bring in new people. It doesn't matter. You're not trying to do this to get exposure.
Yeah.
You're trying to create revenue streams for the artists that are meaningful.
Mm-hmm.
And you're trying to, you're giving ownership to something that's a memory or meaning to an individual where they can cherish it. Because that part of music has disappeared, that I have a piece of it.
Yeah.
It's mine.
Yeah.
I bought it.
That sense of ownership.
And there are, like, I don't know what's out there, whether it's one person who made a lot of money on Bitcoin and wants to own it, or if it's 200 people who want to pass it down to their child.
Yeah. The only thing I would challenge you on in this regard is to say one thing for sure with NFTs is its perceived value. What is the perceived value? And obviously, ultimately, the perceived value is only as great as what somebody will ultimately pay for it. But the perception is often based on the public awareness of the brand. And so at that point, you have to ask yourself, what is the value of Spotify? Because if I'm being listened to by thousands or hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people on Spotify, then what does that do for the perception of the value of my brand? Because we're all hung up on these numbers now, right? We're hung up on social media metrics. We're hung up on subscriber metrics. We're hung up on listener metrics. And that is now becoming the baseline driver for perception of value.
I don't think I'm in that game.
Yeah. Those are the cards we're being dealt right now by the players who want to control this dynamic.
And that's, yeah, and again, you create your own reality. So you can
hop. Oh, I'm so glad you said that. That brings us full circle in this conversation, man. That's awesome.
That's what they're offering you. They're offering you, come on board, and this is the way it is.
Yeah.
And what I'm saying is, let's make a new orchard. We don't like that orchard. We're going to make a whole new one. We're not going to fight off apples that have fallen off trees or scraps. Uh-huh. Let's make a new orchard.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what that is. And I don't really care if there are a million people at our orchard. I care if they're like a handful of people who dig what we do. And there's at least that many. Like when we did the re-release of Delusions of Grandeur, which, you know, it's all DIY. It's not like we're doing this through agents or managers, but did it in a way that brought in a good amount of revenue, way more than I'll make from Spotify in a lifetime, and filled out clubs packed to capacity with fans. What more do you want? Like a bigger club? If there's 1,000 people who'll show up to your show in a couple of cities, that's great. And post-COVID, that's probably beyond great. You're not going to get that.
They talk about we always talk about the super fan, those fans that really care, those are the ones that matter at the end of the day. And so all of those listens, they're so random. And how connected can you be? So yeah, it's a quandary, and I think it's something that every artist is struggling with now. Everybody from guys who are making soundtracks and getting their music streamed now, and whether on games or films, or it's a quandary.
Yeah, it's always changing.
And it's not going away. It doesn't seem like it's going away anytime soon.
Yeah, I get a thrill out of making music.
Yeah.
So the other part of it is just almost necessary and extra and a little bit superfluous.
Yeah.
So as long as I'm making music and getting it out, meaning the getting out is there are degrees to how you get it out. Mm-hmm. The getting it out this week was getting it into the inbox of 300 of the best DJs, most popular DJs in the world.
Yeah.
Like that may be enough as far as the getting out.
Right.
That's how we made our name in the 90s, was sending out a lot of promos.
Mm-hmm.
And if it showed up in your front door and you had it in your hand and it was exceptional, then they use it, they play it. I wouldn't even try compete.
What does a Hardkiss fat drop look like now?
What does the what look like?
A Hardkiss fat drop. When you're dropping those tracks on the DJs, what are you doing? How do you get, what are you doing? Is it an email to their inbox with a link? Is it a download? Is it are you dropping vinyl to their doorstep?
It could be vinyl, but for the new releases, it isn't. So I'm always putting out new music and focusing on that. So what it was this last 2 weeks was hiring a private friend of a friend who has a service to do that for me.
Yeah. So then you get it out there on the list and...
Yeah, it's get it to everyone who might be curious. Get it into the inbox of those who would be curious. I don't have those lists myself, but also I don't have those relationships myself.
Mm-hmm.
it's having somebody who has the relationship.
Yeah, well, this business is built on relationships. Mm-hmm. And I'm grateful for the relationship I've been developing with you.
Yeah, man, we've had a good time from those hippie parties in Marin, which were classic.
Yeah.
And I think that period is over because I don't know who lives in that house anymore. But we had some good times on the dance floor there, that's for sure. And then going to hear Lee Burridge, that was super fun.
At the Midway.
At the Midway, that was super
cool. So glad that they were able to rock those outdoor events as hard as they have. I actually really hope they don't stop doing those because for me, those are hugely enjoyable.
And yeah, I feel like electronic music is moving out of this, like, in a nightclub mentality.
Right, right.
We've had festivals for whatever the last 10 years, but I do love this idea of outdoors, whether it's clubs that are outdoors, and also different times of the day. 2 a.m. to 6 a.m. is cool, but I also like 2 p.m. till 8 p.m.
Totally love it. Love being able to actually even have conversations with friends, and the fact that they aren't playing it over 100 decibels makes that possible. And all kinds of interesting side effects that hopefully we'll learn from and grow from post-COVID.
Man. I appreciate you having me here. Thank you, Greg.
It's been my pleasure, Gavin. And I'm looking forward to mixing ping pong with you.
Let's do it, man.
So we're going to live stream that. So stay tuned. Check us out. We're going to do some live streaming, some mixing coming up soon.
Awesome. Thank you.
You're welcome, Gavin. It's been a lot of fun. Take care.